Well, hey, we're on kind of an unusual way to start the service this morning, but wanted to let you know before we get into the main part that for whatever reasons, our video camera decided to take a long ride on the struggle bus this morning. And there are a number of places in our video where the focus goes in and out. We pretty much got it solved by the time we get to the sermon, but you'll see a couple places where the focus just goes haywire. So sorry about that. We'll try to make sure we get it figured out and fixed by next week, but the audio is still there, so just close your eyes for a while. Let's get ready to worship God.
Well, friends, welcome. So I sat down to write out the announcements today. I thought I could probably just play you last week's announcements because, you know, not a whole lot has changed since then. The only thing that's changed is my hair is a little longer. In fact, I picked up my hairbrush in the bathroom a couple days ago and saw a long blonde strand of hair in it. And I thought, why is my wife using my hairbrush? And then I realized it was my hair. So, you know, now with decisions on hold at the county and the state level, you know, the changes in the timeline just aren't coming for us. And I will say, and I keep mentioning this, that even when we return, there'll be changes. We will probably not have congregational singing for a while. Beginning to discover that would be a tremendous way to spread the virus. And I know that the idea of coming together to worship and not singing just seems so incredibly wrong, but it's going to be probably the right thing to do, at least initially. We're obviously going to have to number the amount of people in the sanctuary. Keep those 6 feet separations we're getting used to. We'll encourage people to wear masks. And now, of course, we'll return to doing the live streaming of our worship services that we had done before this to keep people connected who can't be here or don't feel that they're ready to come back yet. And of course, remember that our quilters continue to make cloth masks for people in our congregation who want them. And if you want some, just shoot us an email. Let us know how many you need, and we'll tell you. By the way, our voicemail system is not working all that well. What a change. And so sometimes email right now is a little better way to connect with us. Do want to continue to thank you for your regular financial gifts we receive. They're really being helpful. We know a lot of you are mailing them in or dropping them off or using our online donation system that's working very well. I'll tell you that tomorrow we're going to mail out a mini newsletter for May. It'll have some information about the re-roofing project that we have decided to move forward on and a few other things, just sort of letting you know where things are at and what we're trying to plan. And finally, as I say every time we meet like this, you know, try to approach this as a time of real worship. Remember that we are gathering in front of a computer screen or a phone screen, but we're really gathering in the Lord's presence, and that's what really matters. So let us be called to worship with the words of Psalm 9. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. I will recount all of your wonderful deeds. I will be glad and exult in you. Those who know your name put their trust in you, O Lord. You have never forsaken those who seek you. I will sing praise to your name, O Most High. Let us worship God.
See?
as we approach our time of prayer, I would like to thank those of you who are trying to keep us aware of the prayers that you have. Encourage you to let us know what's going on. If there are things we can specifically pray for on Sunday morning, you know, send us an email, send it to my address, and we'll do our best to incorporate that into our Sunday worship prayers. So let's bow our hearts in prayer again this morning, even as we are separated today. Father, you know those who need our prayers. You know them even before we pray for them. You know the people our heart worries about, longs to pray for. And yet we also know that even as we pray like this, that prayer changes us as much as it changes the world. And we ask you to help us continue in the daily discipline of prayer so that our relationship with you continues to strengthen and grow, and we can still do your work and your will through intercession. We continue to pray for a member here who has been taken back to the hospital after an illness and a surgery and now with some lung issues. We pray that the fluid which is collected will be drained successfully, that the problem will go away, that she will be more comfortable and continue her recovery. We continue to pray and renew our prayers for Greg Phelps, who continues with this debilitating shoulder pain that has come back again. We pray that the treatments which we're promising will start working again. So we pray that he can also begin to continue his recovery without being quite so laid up. We pray again for the friend of Carol Thompson, her oral surgery, and we pray for a successful procedure and a quick recovery. We pray for Robin Hagen's uncle, diagnosed with terminal cancer. And we do boldly pray for healing, Lord. But we also pray that your will be done, that in whatever circumstance you give the family strength to endure this. Encourage them with the hope of eternal life beyond this temporary life for those who are called by God to be in Christ in this life and in the life to come. We pray for the people in our community recently diagnosed with COVID. We pray that this remains contained and are reminded that we still need your protection and your healing and that this is not over. We especially pray that blessing and protection on those who are serving in what we now recognize as the front lines of this crisis and may very well have a weariness setting in, from grocery clerks to doctors and everyone in between. So many are giving so much. Give them your strength in their weariness. Give them your comfort in their concern. And we too pray for patience as we continue to endure this. We know that many people are tired. Many workers and businesses are suffering. We ask for your wisdom for those who bear the incredible life and death burden of making these decisions, that we might be patient as we await the right time to begin our old activities, even if they are in a new normal. And we continue to pray that you will care for the sick and the lonely, the scared, the isolated, so that by your power and grace, this illness will be overcome and come to a quick and complete end. And so hear us, Father, as we pray with the words that you taught us, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Thank you.
friends, as we start our sermon this morning back into Ephesians chapter 2, I do want to start like I've already done once before, probably would do again, by backtracking a bit into last week's reading to highlight something important I didn't have time to get to, and that's simply verse 10. Let me quickly remind you what came before verse 10. It's actually kind of similar in structure from what we'll study today. Paul first reminds his readers how sinful, lost, and hopeless they were. But then he reminds them of how, by grace, in Christ, and you'll see that again and again and again through this letter, in Christ, how in Christ God redeems us, saves us, raises us up with Christ, and calls us in this immeasurable riches of his grace that God has chosen for us in Christ. Now, we miss the last part of this, and that's important because it both completes the picture and gives you a taste of what's to come in the last part of the letter. Let me say that if you don't get verse 10, you might mistakenly believe that all Paul has talked about here in God's grace is a very human-centered plan. You know, God does this solely and simply for our benefit. It's kind of the ultimate. It's all about us. But verse 10 gives us the final piece of the picture, and it helps us avoid that critical misunderstanding. Verse 10 reads this, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ," there's in Christ, "created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Now, that is one line just filled with all sorts of meaning, and let me just touch on it briefly. One of the first things it says is that we are God's creation. And I love that idea of being God's workmanship. It's almost like, you know, on the back, instead of a made in USA or made in China sticker, it should say made by God. Whatever else it means is that by whatever means God created humanity, we're not just some accident of biology. We are God's intentional workmanship. And I think that's wonderful to know. Anytime you wonder if you have any real value, just remember who made you. And again, that phrase, in Christ, reminds us that all this is part of our intimate, essential connection with our Savior. It doesn't come without him. And also the connection that the Father has with the Son. Now, let me jump ahead just a bit and say that the third element is that God prepared before. It's clear that what Paul's talking about here is just another element of God's eternal plan for us. Just as we were chosen by God to receive grace in Christ before time, remember verse 1:4, even as God chose us in Christ before the foundations of the world that we should be holy and blameless before him, we see that God's eternal activity included not just who we would be, but what we would do with the grace that we have been given. God didn't just decide to elect you before time began. He decided that your life would have meaning and purpose beyond yourself. You were made to serve God. But finally, this is all wrapped together with that phrase, good works that we should walk in them. Now, let me be sure we don't misunderstand this. Paul doesn't say that God created good works for us to earn our salvation or as a condition of our salvation. They come as a result of our salvation. They are the cart behind the horse. And the idea of walk is important. You know, it's interesting that we look at this word now, when all of a sudden we see so many people outside walking, we never saw walking before. People we had no idea lived near us, now walking by our houses. Paul uses the term walk 7 times in this short letter. And you'll see that this term also starts off this section as well. Now, walk is a Hebrew idiom. That is a single word that describes a more complicated idea, one that describes our manner of life, how we live, who we are, what we value, what we do. And works isn't, you know, what we normally think. It's not just going and volunteering at the food bank or helping a little old lady cross the street. Commentator Peter O'Brien puts it this way, good works are God's design for his new creation and flow from his gracious salvation as its consequence and fruit. In Ephesians 2:10, good works is the general and comprehensive expression of godly behavior. Put simply, it is God's will that those who belong to the new creation should be characterized by a lifestyle which ultimately reflects God's own character and action. So to walk in good works is basically to reflect God's will and values in all you are, in all you do, and all you think, and to do so so visibly in your life that people will see this as you walk your walk. And again, why do we do this? Are we, you know, trying to show everyone how pious and good we are? Absolutely not. Because if this is all God's doing, saving us and giving us godly purpose in our lives, it is God who deserves the credit, not us. Grace saves us, salvation gives us faith, faith devotes us to Christ our Savior, and all this gives glory to God. We walk in God's good works, the ones He prepared for us when He saved us, that we might give glory to God. Remember? Sola Deo Gloria. Okay, now on to verses 11 through 22, which we'll just get started on today. And I think I'll have the scripture read this morning in a nice Scottish accent once again.
Our reading this morning is from Ephesians and chapter 2, reading from the 11th verse to the end of the chapter. Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 11. Therefore remember that at one time you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision, by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands, remember that you were at that time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For He Himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in His flesh the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that He might create in Himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And He came and preached peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through Him we both have access in one Spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus Himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In Him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. Gracious God, we turn now to Your Word. Your Word is fixed in heaven. Your Word is a lamp that shines upon our pathway. You've exalted above all things Your name and Your Word. And so with a great sense of expectation, we turn to it now. Speak, Lord, we pray, for Your Son's sake. Amen.
Now let me start this part of the sermon with a brief but horrific observation. While most of the world is busy fighting COVID-19, people are still fighting each other. We've just stopped noticing. A few days ago, three armed Islamic militant gunmen in Afghanistan stormed into a Doctors Without Borders hospital in Kabul and attacked their maternity ward. 16 mothers and nurses were killed, among them two newborns. It is a horror that is hard to even imagine. From even a short distance, it would be hard for us to tell the difference between the attackers and the victims. Both sides were Afghanis and Muslims. They spoke the same language, shared the same culture, breathed the same air. But some seemingly small division in the midst of the attackers' minds turned them into a them. People so different that their lives could be ended and their blood shed at will. And quite frankly, a lot of human history, a lot of the strife that we face, can simply be boiled down to a simple formula. There is an us and theirs of them. We are better, they are worth less than us. And let me tell you, friends, if you think we as a nation are immune to this, just watch how much news coverage a sinking ferry in Indonesia that takes with it 300 lives gets versus some minor event on our own shores. This shows up in all sorts of ways. Now, friends, you know this is a part of our fallen world, but it is not something God does not have a plan for, and will unfold this plan over this and next week's sermon. Note how this section in the chapter starts. It's basically a shorter version of the dire situation of lost humanity finds itself in at the beginning of the chapter, but it's aimed specifically at the majority of those who would be hearing this letter. People who came out of the Greek and Roman culture, who were not Jews by faith or ethnicity, but were Gentiles. Ethnos is the word in Greek. More broadly, it simply means the nations. And I might remind you, that's pretty much all of you. I had a Jewish father, so you're like all on your own now. Now, in a church that has been mostly a Gentile church for 1900 years, this doesn't seem like a big deal. But remember, in 60 AD, when we think this letter was written, Christianity was still pretty Jewish. And people from outside the church couldn't easily tell the difference between a Jew and someone who claimed to follow a Jewish rabbi. For Jews themselves, their world simply had two divisions, Jews and Gentiles. Again, that Greek word ethnos, meaning all the nations other than Israel. Another way that they would phrase it is either you were one of the circumcised or one of the uncircumcised. And to a Jew, the uncircumcised didn't count for much. Some in Jesus' day would say that the only reason God created Gentiles was so that there would be fuel for the fires of hell. If a Jew married a non-Jew, they would hold a funeral for him because they considered him dead. It was even unlawful for a Jew to help a non-Jewish woman in childbirth, since all that would do would be to bring another Gentile into the world. Every morning, a Jewish man would rise and say his morning prayers. God, I thank you that you didn't create me a woman, a Gentile, or a dog. That was the level of contempt that was often present between Jews and Gentiles in the early church era. And I would note that it is still present in some of the ultra-Orthodox Jews today. Salvation was only for the Jews. God only loved his chosen people. No one else really mattered. Us versus them. Now, if you're a new Christian from Ephesus or one of the surrounding towns who got this letter, it's not unreasonable to wonder how you fit into the plans of the God of the Jews and his divine and risen Jewish rabbi son. So Paul restarts at the beginning with them. In one sentence, Paul gives a brutal but accurate summary of the circumstances that these Gentiles were in before God's grace came to them. Again, it's chapter 2, verse 12. Remember that you were at one time separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. One commentator notes that in one brief sentence, Paul tells them that they were Christless, stateless, friendless, hopeless, and godless. Christless, stateless, friendless, hopeless, and godless. Wow. And by the way, this diagnosis is just as true today of non-Christians as it was then. And I would suspect that it was just as offensive and politically incorrect 1960 years ago in Ephesus. Remember, this is a place that considers itself the religious capital of the world, just as offensive as it is today when we Christians say the world is lost without Jesus Christ. But God has a plan. In fact, the next verse starts with, but now, just like a few verses ago, Paul started verse 4 with, but God. Let me read the whole thing again, verses 13 through 19. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ, his sacrifice on the cross. Then this very important verse, verse 14. For he himself is our peace, who has made us both one and has broken down in his flesh, pay attention to this, the dividing wall of hostility by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself, in Christ, one new man in the place of two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both to God in one body through the cross, whereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. And through him, we both have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now, let me make two observations here and then wrap up. First, note that Paul uses the word peace four times here. So it's obviously a key concept. It's a key concept for Paul. It occurs 48 times in Paul's letters, 8 in Ephesians. Now, we tend to think of peace as the absence of war or conflict. To the Hebrews and to Paul, it was a heck of a lot more. Kein Snodgrass notes this. He says, Paul summarized the gospel simply by saying, he, Christ, is our peace. Peace is not simply the cessation of hostility. It is a comprehensive term for salvation and life with God. It refers to the way life should be and the gift that God that is received only in his presence. Peace is what God wills for his people. So peace is the complete blessing of a God who reconciled you to himself by the sacrifice of his son on the cross. And note so very carefully that God does not give us peace without giving it to us in Christ. Peace is not a state of being. For Christians, it is a person. And without Christ, there can and will be no true or lasting peace. Our human efforts at peace are wonderful and should be encouraged and supported, but they will never be fully or finally successful because they lack the one true thing that brings real peace, and that's Jesus Christ. Let me finish with a final observation, but an important one that really ties this all together. I ask you to think back a few weeks in our introduction. Remember the context of this letter. We believe that Paul is writing this letter while he is under house arrest in Rome. Now, that arrest started well over 2 years before, when Paul was in Jerusalem on the Temple Mount. Now, on the Temple Mount, there was a low wall that separated the court of the Gentiles. It was the only place on the Temple Mount where a non-Jewish worshiper could go so that he could go there and pray, from the inner courtyards of the temple that were open only to Jews. In fact, if you went to Turkey with me a few years ago, you saw one of the original signs that were on this wall from the first century. They were written in Latin and Greek alternately, and it read this, and I love what they write on it. It says, "No stranger is to enter within the wall round the temple and enclosure. Whoever is caught will be himself responsible for his ensuing death." Now, before his arrest, when Paul was in Jerusalem, people had seen him walking around with a non-Jew. Interestingly enough, we learn in Acts that it was a man named Trophimus, who Luke tells us actually was a Christian from Ephesus. So when the Jews see Paul actually in the inner court of the temple, they assume he's brought Trophimus with him, past that dividing barrier, and they riot. They drag Paul out, can't kill him in the temple. They drag him outside the temple to kill him, and they would have killed him if not Roman soldiers had come down from the Antonia fortress that was set there to oversee the temple and intervened and saved him. Eventually, he gets arrested, sent to Caesarea for 2 years, and then on to Rome. Now, you can only imagine that Trophimus eventually made his way back to Ephesus and certainly told this story to everybody there, and all the Christians there must have wondered how they ever could have been counted among God's people if they were hated that much by them. And the answer is this, and Paul knows they need to hear it, that in Christ, Christ has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility. Do you see how an Ephesian might understand that in a more personal and direct way than maybe anybody else would? The truth is a big truth, that Christ's intention was nothing short of completely reinventing our human race, to create in himself, in him, one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace. You know, as a society, we keep looking ways to end war and strife. And as such, it's a noble cause, a part of the common grace that God has granted all humankind and is worthy of praise. But it will never solve the problem of the divisiveness of sin, for we will ever subdivide ourselves into us and them. Only in Christ, in his flesh, in his body, is this division abolished and a new humanity created. We'll talk more about what that looks like and what that means for us and for the church next week. But remember this, that you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. Let us pray. Father, what a wonder this passage is for us, that it reminds us that as lost as we were, by the grace that you have for us, that you have called us to yourself, forgiven us in Christ, made us one with all of your people, and given us a peace that surpasses understanding, that the world cannot know because it does not know you. Help us to live into this new reality and see who we really are as the body of Christ. For we pray these things in the name of him who is our peace, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Friends, now receive the benediction again from Ephesians. Now unto him who is able to do far more abundantly than all the things that we ask or think, according to the power that is at work within us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. May God bless you all and be with us until we meet again. Bye.